Simon & Schuster Audio presents Getting Clean with Stevie Green by Swan Huntley. Read by Emily Tremaine. With Amanda Carlin, Emily Ellett, Gibson Fraser, and Allison Ryan.
For my dad, Mark Huntley, who had such exuberance for life that he made hummingbirds look depressed. 1950 to 2019. And for anyone who feels like a mess. Visible mess helps distract us from the true source of the disorder. Marie Kondo. Trying to define yourself is like trying to bite your own teeth. Alan Watts.
Part 1. Yes. Chapter 1. Stevie. It's so hard to know who you are. That's why I'm constantly looking in the mirror. Who am I? Who am I now? What about now? I check myself out from various angles, trying to clock a change. That's what people do in moments of transition, right? If nothing else, I find the sight of my reflection soothing. In my head, I'm a mess. But in the mirror, I'm solid. I'm a woman who has her life in order. I dress well. I do my hair. I have an open, friendly face. You would ask me for directions. You would trust me with your children. If I were a town, I would probably be my hometown. La Jolla, California is a place with a winning exterior. It dresses well. It's ordered. It's warm. Its lucky placement on a breathtaking portion of the Southern California coastline means it's never had to try too hard. An image of La Jolla is an image of an easy life. Considering the fortunate circumstances under which I grew up, there should have been no reason for my easy life to turn into a trash fire. Except for that it did. Why? Because of one incident. I would call this one the inciting incident. Unfortunately, the inciting incident had been on my mind all the time since moving home 6 months earlier, but it also wasn't the point. The point, I said to myself in the rearview, is about starting over now. The light turned green. It was another perfect sunny day in La Jolla, and I was driving to the house of a new client, Lauren Strong. I liked to use my car time to practice my spiel, and this is what I did now. First, I quelled any potential embarrassment with my usual reminder. If anyone sees me talking to myself, they'll assume that I am on the phone. I cleared my throat, and then I began.
Do you have a picture in your mind of the person you want to become? And a profound sense of how you'll feel when you become that person? Are you almost there, but not quite yet? If so, then let me help you. The difference between a clean life and a clean enough life might look small from afar, but it's actually the Grand Canyon. Yes, you can put on a show for people. Yes, you can lie. Yes, you can live in a palace and wear great clothes and say the right things, but if your closets are packed to the brim with stuff you don't need, and if you also feel a little bit dead inside, then who cares how sparkly your life looks to other people? If it doesn't feel clean to you, then it's not. I was practicing my spiel for Lauren, of course, but I was also practicing for a more successful future, possibly one that included a TV spot or a book tour, some professional event that starred me, a woman who was mic'd and teeming with unbreakable confidence. There would be a newly waxed stage and a rapt audience, and somewhere nearby, a poster that said, Stevie Green, Decluttering Guru. Now, you're probably like, well, okay, I think my life could be cleaner, and why isn't it already? I paused here for dramatic effect. Because you don't know what you want, and that's okay. Not knowing what you want makes you like everyone else. It also really sucks, and you don't need to live that way anymore. The solution is simple, but there are no shortcuts. Actually, we're taking the long way to make sure we haven't left anything out. In order to figure out what you really want,
We're going to start by getting rid of everything you don't want. You know that guess and check thing you used to do in math class? Have you heard the song, The Long Way Around? It's like that. By saying goodbye to all the incorrect answers, we'll land at the right one. And the right one is your clean and honest life. Out of habit, I opened the center console and counted the bottles of Screwtop Chardonnay with my hand. 1, 2, 3. I didn't want to drink them. That's why I kept them close by, to remind myself. I'd imagine the taste of buttery wine and feel the hot prick at the back of my throat and think, no thanks. They were like a stress ball. They reduced my stress. Plus, they were tiny and taking up barely any room in my life, so who cared? Your stuff is holding you back and weighing you down. You're drowning in it, I said, slamming the center console shut. But not anymore. It's time to free yourself. It's time to become who you are. Chapter 2, Stevie. Lauren Strong was a stay-at-home mom whose shopping problems had led her to the brink of divorce. That's how she'd put it in her message to me.
My husband's nickname for me is Overkill. We're on the brink of divorce. The brink part might have had extra meaning for Lauren since she lived at the edge of a cliff. Her house was a modern marvel, 4 stories high, with an industrial, unfinished vibe. Basically, it looked like some rectangles in a pile, set just slightly askew. Cement, wood, glass. The elements, in their naked forms, were easy to identify. I turned off the engine and reminded myself that I wasn't a see-through person. If you believe in you, then she'll believe in you. Then I got out of the car, a brand new Volvo station wagon that made me look like a higher earner than I was, and walked with gusto toward the wooden gate just in case anybody was watching. I often did things like this, with the understanding that somebody might be watching. It was good because it made me try harder to be the person I wanted to be all the time. If my ex-friend-slash-life-destroyer Chris saw me right now, she'd see what I saw in the mirror. A woman who was solid and on her way somewhere. In the 6 months since moving home, I hadn't seen Chris, not even once, but I was always expecting to see her. She'd been a central character in my head ever since we'd stopped talking. From the sidewalk, Lauren's architectural choices gave the impression that she was a minimalist, but she'd warned me about this in her message. It's not real. When I opened the gate, I saw what she meant. Lauren's suspiciously green lawn, which I'd realize in a second was astroturf, was almost invisible underneath an ocean of Fisher-Price goods. The plastic primary colors shone with manufactured radiance under the sun-filled sky. It either looked like the wildest dreams of a child who watched a lot of commercials or a genetics lab for toys, because everything was multiplied. Those red cars with the yellow tops that every kid has, I quickly counted 6 of them. And then I imagined lining them all up and putting the other repeat items together, because that was always the first step. Ordering the mess so you could see it clearly, just as you would with a jigsaw puzzle. You'd put the like colors in a pile. Obvious. Well, it was obvious to me, but apparently it was not so obvious to other people who were stuck in amateur hour gathering up the edges first. A total mistake, because then you had to hop all the other pieces over the edge later. Why do that? The acrobatics were unnecessary. I quickly assessed that 75% of Lauren's Fisher-Price goods needed to go, and further assessed that with caffeine in my system and my Hokas on my feet, I could get the job done myself within 45 minutes. I felt a little bit high thinking about this, because that's how much I enjoyed the act of making sense of a life, or at least of an area. I loved organizing for the same reason I loved vacuuming. Immediate, tangible results, which were so unlike the slow, mysterious shifts of the internal self. Inconveniently,
I wasn't going to get the job done by myself, however, because the decluttering business doesn't work that way. People want to hash things out first. People want to be heard. Sometimes they want to have long conversations about what a particular hat or brooch or dented-ass picture frame means to them. And mostly, they want to make excuses for why they need things they don't really need. I'm usually patient, except for the times I want to wring a client's neck and scream, "Make a choice, sister." It was for this reason that I'd recently decided to implement a 5-second rule. Lauren would be the first client to hear about it. "You're here!" Lauren called from the doorway with so much enthusiasm that I could tell she was lonely. It made me feel better. Lauren, barefoot, with her morning hair all tangled up, was vulnerable. She had issues, and she wasn't trying to hide them. She was being her real.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.